Take your Bibles, if you will, and turn with me to the book of Proverbs, Proverbs chapter 6, Proverbs chapter 6. This morning we're going to continue our series entitled Think of the Ant. Started it last week, and if you missed last Sunday was kind of the springboard to kind of launch us into this new series. That's why the t-shirt, Think of the Ant. Think ant, not can't. We've got to be changing our thinking. What we discovered last week was that tiny, tiny changes in our thinking, in our attitudes and our actions can bring tremendous changes in our results. Just little things. If we just tweak our lives in some very small ways, doesn't have to be anything dramatic, but little changes done consistently over time can bring tremendous changes in the results that we seek. Proverbs chapter 6, beginning in verse 6. Have you found it? Hold your Bibles up. We're going to look at a couple of passages this morning, so you've got to keep your fingers kind of loosened up. Listen to what it says. It says, "Go to the ant, you sluggard. Consider her ways and be wise." I don't know. I guess if there's anything worse, there is nothing worse than being on a trip and being lost. You ever been there? Nothing worse than being on a trip and being, maybe there's one thing worse. Being lost and being stupid. That would be worse, I think, if you're on a trip and lost and stupid. Maybe there's a trifecta. If you're lost and you're stupid and you're broke, that could be really bad. You know what I mean? Okay, one more. If you're lost and you're stupid and you're broke and you're ugly, that would be the worst thing. Okay, there's nothing I can do about the last one. I mean, if you think if I could do anything about that, I'd have this face. I mean, let's be honest. I'm here to tell you something. We discovered last week when we started studying ants that their life expectancy is really, really short. They live 45 to 60, 90 days maximum. Days. Life is too short to be seen as anything but an adventure. I don't want to go on a trip. I don't want to go on a journey and get lost. And if I go on a journey and I don't know where I'm going, I don't want to be stupid about it. And if I go on a journey and I don't know what I'm doing, I don't want to be broke and stupid on top of being lost. And I certainly don't want to be ugly. But I'm here to tell you, what we can learn from the ant is that we don't have to be lost. That God has a plan. And what we can learn from the ant is that we don't have to be stupid. We can go to the ant and be wise. And we don't have to be broke. We can enjoy the treasures that he has to offer to us. And we don't even have to be ugly because we can be beautiful in his sight. We have been called to be on a journey, to be on an adventure. We learn that from the ant. You know what the ant does with that 40, that 60, that 90 days? That ant does everything it can. It gathers all the food that it can. It goes everywhere that it can. It sees everything that it can. The ant goes and does because it's got a purpose and a meaning for life. It knows that life is an adventure. It never once stops and thinks, "I'm about to die." It just keeps living. And that's what we should do as well. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Genesis chapter 12. We're going to look at two very important examples of living life as an adventure. Repeat this after me. God wants me to live life as an adventure. Carol Bartram came out this morning. He said he's got a new word, adventure. That's what life is supposed to be, an adventure. Life is not something to endure, it is something to enjoy. Life is to be an adventure. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Listen as I read, beginning in verse 1. "Now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, from your father's house, to a land I will show you." What he's saying? He's saying, "Abram, come and go with me on an adventure. Go with me on a journey. You don't have to know all the destinations. You don't have to know everything there is to know about it. Just come and go with me." Listen to what he says. "And I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing, and I will bless those who bless you. I will curse him who curses you, and in you all the families of the earth will be blessed." What an adventure. Take your Bibles, turn with me to the Gospel of Mark. Another example of what we're talking about. We're going to be referring back to these passages. This is in Mark chapter 1. Are you there? Hold your Bibles up when you found it. Mark chapter 1. I'll give you a little more time. Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1. All right, everybody that's found it, hold your Bibles up. If it's not in the Word, we don't want to deal with it. In Mark chapter 1, the calling of His disciples. Listen to what it says, beginning in verse 16. Now as He, Jesus, walked by the Sea of Galilee, He saw Simon and Andrew, His brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Jesus said to them, "Follow Me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and they followed Him. What a powerful passage. What two great examples of men that strike out on an adventure. They don't know where they're going to end up. They're just following. There was no destination. In fact, Peter in one of the other Gospels comes to Jesus and says, "Where do you sleep?" And Jesus, this is his answer, "Come see." What an adventure. God is calling us and inviting us to live life at a different level. He's calling us to live life as an adventure. We learn that from the ants. Life is too short. You may have 40 or 60 or 90 years. Let me tell you, some of us are on borrowed time. It's too short not to live life to the fullest. Live it. What should you do? Everything you can. How many people should you touch? Every person you can. How much money should you earn? All that you can. How much of a difference should you make? As much as you can. Because life is to be an adventure. Life is to be lived as an adventure. So I'm packed. I'm ready to go. I've got my backpack here ready to lead out on the adventure of a lifetime. The first thing that we discover in this passage, the first thing we discover is that, number one, this adventure called life, it begins with a relationship with God. Here's the Word right here. This is my Bible. I just pulled it out of my backpack because it reminds me that my life is really about a relationship with Him. It is about my relationship with Him. I will never truly enjoy life. I can endure it, I can exist, but I can't really enjoy it until I know Him. The reality is that God wants to be in a relationship with me and with you. You say, "Well, preacher, wait a minute, this is where your analogy breaks down. The ant doesn't know Him." Are you sure? Are you really sure about that? Back in the book of Genesis, the first chapter, verses 24 and 25, we find these words. It says that God, in that creative process, He was creating the beast of the field. And then He says, and He created everything that creeps and crawls on the ground. The creeping and crawling things. I would say an ant is a creeping and crawling thing, wouldn't you? Anybody agree with me on that one? And you know what He said after He created them? He looked at what He had made, and this is what He said. It's good. God created those creatures and said it was good. The book of Isaiah the prophet, when he's talking about the children of Israel and how they had strayed from God and fallen into their sins, this is what he said. He says, "The beast of the field, they honor me." Amazing, isn't it? That the creation honors the Creator. You see, the reality is, these ants that we've been talking about, these ants that we've been studying, they do understand something that you and I forget, that we must begin our life, that this adventure called life, by being in relationship with Him. See, there are two important days in everybody's life. The day that we're born and the day we discover why we were born. Not the day that we die, the day we discover why we're here. Listen, every obituary, every tombstone, every grave marker has a date of birth and a date of death. It's the dash that separates those two. That's where the adventure called life is lived. That's where we learn how to be the person that God wants us to be. These passages that we just read together. Now the Lord said to Abram, and Jesus, as He walked by the Sea of Galilee, He saw Simon and Andrew, His brother, casting a net into the sea. They were fishermen. One of the complimentary passages in the Gospel says that He actually got into their boat. He had a relationship with them. and what he invited Abram to, and what he invited Simon and Andrew to, and what he invites you and me to is relationship. He says, come and go with me. I'll show you where you're going to end up, but come and go with me. It's an adventure. It's an adventure. My wife Betsy loves to go on trips, but we're different. I can get in the car and take off driving. I don't have to know how far I'm going in one day. She plots out every hour in that day. By this time we should be here, and by this time we should be here, and the reservation is for here. And I'm going, life is an adventure. I'm like the ant. The ant doesn't know what's past that next sprig of grass, but it's on its way. And that's where we're headed. We're on our way. God wants me to see my life as an adventure. He wants me to understand that the reason I was born, I've given this passage to you. Revelation 4:11 says, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will or by your pleasure they exist and were created. Let me tell you why I'm here. Because He wanted to take pleasure in me. Let me tell you why you're here. Not to earn a living, but because He wants to take pleasure in you. He wants to be in a relationship with us. Isn't that great news? Life is an adventure. And the first step in that adventure is to get with the guy taking us on the journey. It's to meet Jesus Christ. It's to come to God and begin that journey with a relationship with Him. Second thing that we discover is that this life called an adventure, this adventure that we call life, that it involves risk, always involves risk. This is my first aid kit. And reward. These are coin wrappers. When the ant takes off, I got to tell you something about them. They don't know what's beyond that next leaf. It could be an anteater. That's pretty risky if you're an ant. Or it could be a chocolate chip cookie. That's pretty rewarding if you're an ant. Well, hey, that's pretty rewarding if you're a human. Chocolate chip cookie. Getting close to lunchtime, making me hungry now. The reality is that there is always risk and reward. You read the story of Abram. We read the passage, and this is what it said. It said God came to Abram and said, Abram, this is what I want you to do. I want you to step out of your comfort zone. I want you to leave your parents, leave your family, leave your homeland. Come and go to a place I'm going to show you. That's risk. It's risky business when you follow God. When Jesus came to the disciples, He came to them and He said, come and follow me. I'll make you become fishers of men. And this is what the Bible says. And immediately they left their nets. They left their families. They left their jobs behind. They went and followed Him. That's risky. We're talking risky business here. When you live life as an adventure, you accept the risk knowing that the reward is coming. Knowing that it's out there. Sometimes we get it here on this earth. Sometimes we have to wait till all eternity. But the reward is coming. It's going to be there. We're going to find it. We're going to discover it. Listen to what He says. Now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country, from your family, from your father's house to a land that I will show you. That's risk. And I will make you a great nation. And I will bless you. And I will make your name great. That's reward. Sounds pretty good to me. That's an adventure. And then in Mark chapter 1, verses 16 through 18, this is the risk. As Jesus walked by the Sea of Galilee, saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. Jesus said to them, follow me, I will make you become fishers of men. And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And keep going, go to the next page, Mark 10, 28 through 30. Peter comes to Jesus and asks him this question. He said, we've left all to follow you. There's the risk. And Jesus answered and said, assuredly I say to you, there is no one, say no one. There is no one who has left houses or brothers or sisters or fathers or mothers or wives or children or lands for my sake and the gospel who shall not receive a hundredfold now in this time. Houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecution and in the age to come eternal life. There's risk and reward. When we journey on this adventure with God, there is always risk and reward. There's always those moments when we say goodbye because we know somewhere we're going to say hello. 30 years ago, my wife and I said goodbye. We left our families. We left our friends. We moved to Kansas City to go to seminary. In our minds, the journey was, the adventure was going to take us back. But guess what? We haven't been able to get away from Kansas City. 30-plus years we've been in Kansas City. My children gave up their cousins. My children gave up their uncles and aunts. My children gave up getting to know their grandparents. They're not close to them. But I have to tell you, the risk was worth the reward, because my children have any number of people that would adopt them as grandparents, and that have over the years adopted them. And they have a multitude of young people that are their kinfolks, their brothers and sisters, their cousins in the faith that have stepped in. Listen, there is risk involved, but there's reward that comes. What we discover is that life with God is measurably better than life without God. Psychiatrists, psychologists have studied this for years. One doctor in the University of Miami down in Florida, he did a study. He studied religious belief for 10-year period, and this is what he came up with. He said that people that claim to have a relationship with God, they make better grades in school. They make more money in the workplace. They have more satisfying marriage relationships. They live longer. They heal from surgery quicker. These are all documented things that they've studied. Isn't it amazing? The risk is great. You may be persecuted. You may be cursed. But the reward is good. The reward is great. Listen, anytime you go on an adventure, you better take your first aid kit. But you better be ready to pick up the coins. There's always risk and there's always reward. Third thing that we discover, and this is my favorite part of it. It's not about what I am, but it's about what I'm becoming. What are you becoming? Did you notice what happened to Abram? This is the guy we call Abraham. Father Abraham, you know who I'm talking about? Abram. When we're introduced to him in chapter 12, it's just plain old Abram. God says, come and go with me on an adventure. And then he says this, he says, and I will make you. I will make you something. I will make you the father of a nation. I will bless you and make your name great. Isn't that amazing? And to the disciples, to Simon Peter, God spoke to him. And this is what he said. Jesus spoke to him and said, when you follow me, go on the adventure with me, I'm going to make you to become fishers of men. Let me tell you something. We're supposed to be becoming something. It's not about what I am today. It's about what I'm becoming. Let me ask you something. Guys, are you becoming a better husband? Are you becoming a better father? Are you becoming a better spiritual leader of your household? Are you becoming a deeper Christian, a better follower of Jesus Christ? It's not about what I am. It's about what I'm becoming. Ladies, are you a better wife? Are you becoming a better wife? Are you becoming a better mother? Are you becoming a better friend? Are you becoming a better employer or an employee? You're supposed to be becoming something. Something should be happening to us. You see, the truth is, this is not about what I am today. It wasn't for Abraham and it wasn't for Simon. It's about what I'm becoming. You know, ants just are ants, right? They don't become anything else. It's not like a caterpillar becomes a butterfly. But you know what? I discovered something about ants as I studied them. There's about 12,000 different types of ants. And the scientists got together and they did a study of one particular type of ant. And what they found was that what the ant took in, the ant became. And the same thing is true about you and me. What we take in, we become. What we focus our attention on, what we believe about ourselves. The scripture says, as a man believes in his heart, so shall it be. What they did is they put colored sugar water out. And they had these ants who had translucent abdomens. They had them come and eat the sugar water. Let me show you the results. Put up the first slide, guys. You see that? Isn't that a cool picture? That ant is eating green sugar water, and it's becoming green. What it takes in, it becomes. Now, just so you know that they didn't just paint one ant, go on to the next slide, guys. Look at there. There's a yellow one, and in the back, there's a red one. Depending on the kind of sugar water they took, what they take in, they become. Go to the next one, guys. Look at the multitudes. What they take in, they become. Let me tell you something about you and me. Your brain and my brain does not care what you put in it. But what you put in it will bring forth a harvest. What you put in it, you will become. It's like a farm field. Ron Begum was in the early service this morning. Ron's a farmer. Ron can go out and he can plow up a field. And that field really doesn't care. That dirt doesn't care whether he plants corn, whether he plants soybean, or whether he plants poison ivy. But I got to tell you, depending on what he plants, that will determine what he gets. If he plants poison ivy, he's going to have a bumper crop of poison ivy. The same thing is true about you and me. Our brains are like that soil. If we put in negative and negative and negative, we will become negative. If we focus on the bad, we will become bad. We need to improve our filtration system. Found a new water bottle. You know, the older I get, the less my throat dries out. So I drink a lot of water up here. I've got my water bottle down. This one's neat, though, because it's got a filtration device built into it. Because we learn something about the physical body. We know that what we take in impacts who we are. Let me tell you something. You can go to the internet, you can take in a lot of stuff, but you better be careful because what you take in, you will become. You can turn on your television set and take in a lot of stuff, but what you take in, you become. See, this is why it's important for us to be in worship on a regular basis. It's why it's important for us to be in God's Word on a regular basis. Because what we take in, we become. Last Sunday, Kendall shared part of her faith. She shared her experience. And she quoted from the book of Jeremiah. And you know what? That wasn't something she's just recently learned. That was something she learned years ago as a Bible driller. See, years ago, the seed was planted. Years ago in Bible drill, that seed was planted. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a future and to give you a hope. And I don't know about you, but I was moved when she shared that. But I got to tell you something. That's because the seed was planted. The Bible says God will not be mocked. Whatever you sow, you will. Yeah. So I need to be filtering the things that I let in. This life that's lived is an adventure. It's about what I'm becoming. If I want to become a better husband, then I need to associate with men who are good husbands. I need to be reading books that will help me to become a good husband. If I want to be a better father, then I better be watching people and following people who I believe are good fathers. If I want to be a stronger follower of Jesus Christ, I need to be in a church that preaches and teaches the Word of God. Because what I take in, just like the ants, it's what I become. It will at the very least color your life. You know what I'm talking about? It will make a difference. And then lastly, number four, it's about letting God use my experience to move me from where I am to where I need to be. We read in the passage, and this is what the Lord said to Abraham, I will bless those that bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And when he spoke to Simon Peter, he said, we're going to have all this stuff with persecution. Wait a minute, I didn't sign on for the cursing and the persecution. Didn't know that was part of it. Let me tell you, you start following God on the adventure, people will look at you funny. And some people will talk about you funny. And some people will even curse your life and they will pick on you because of your faith. The question is, what am I going to do when that happens? It is inevitable that you and I will falter. It is inevitable that you and I will stumble. It is inevitable that we will fall. The question isn't will we fall. The question is will we get back up. The question is will we let the fall break us or will we bounce? That Simon Peter character, will we bounce? Bounce. Bounce! Get it? I keep it in there to remind me. God wants me to bounce. Now think about it. Simon Peter denied Christ three times. He failed. Judas Iscariot He denied Jesus Christ, sold him for 30 pieces of silver. But they both made choices. One chose to bounce, the other broke. The Bible says that Judas went out and hanged himself. That he took his life. He gave up on the adventure. And Simon Peter allowed the impact of that fall. The Bible says that he went out and he wept and he repented and it propelled him higher. He bounced and became one of the leaders in the early church. You know what? We don't have to be lost. We can be in a relationship with God. We don't have to be stupid. We can look at the ant and learn and be wise. We don't have to be broke. We can enjoy the treasures that our Heavenly Father has for us. We don't have to be ugly because we're beautiful in His sight. Let me ask you something. Are you becoming the person that God wants you to be? Is He moving you from where you are? Listen, every experience that you and I have, I don't like all my experience. I don't like all the experiences you have to go through. But I know this, my God can transfer that experience into something good. Listen to what the Scripture says. Romans 8:28, listen to it. And we know that, how many things? And we know that all things, say all. Isn't that amazing? And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to His purpose. All things. Seriously, you mean all things? I mean all things. It doesn't mean I have to enjoy going through that process, but I understand I'm on the adventure with God and He can take the bad that comes into my life. He can take the curses and He can take the persecution and He can take the problems and He can take the crisis and He can use all that to move me from where I am to the person that I need to be. God can move me through my experience. I don't have to be lost. I don't have to be stupid. I don't have to be broke. I don't have to be ugly. I can live life as an adventure. So how do we start? How do we begin this adventure-filled life? Three steps. Number one, I must accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. That's what I'm looking for here. I don't want to be a success. I want to do something significant. I don't want to just have an average life. I want to have an exceptional life. I don't want to be mundane. I want to live in the realm of the miraculous. I want to be on the adventure. And the way that I begin that is to accept Jesus Christ. He said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. The very first thing I have to do is accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior. Second thing. I have to commit myself to follow Him. I have to make a decision that I'm going to get in His book. I'm going to get in His Word. I'm going to follow the map that He's laid out before me. I'm going to apply it to my life. I'm going to be in church. I'm going to make a decision. I'm not just going to keep going back and forth and back and forth. I'm going to get in the adventure. I'm going to pack my bags and be ready to go. I'm on a journey. Listen, going on a journey with God sometimes make you pack funny things like shirts with ants on them. But I'm on a journey. I'm on an adventure. And I'm committed to following Him. And then lastly, I'm going to trust Him to transform me. I'm going to trust Him to change my attitudes and my actions. I'm going to trust Him to make those tiny changes that if I do them consistently will transform my results. I'm going to trust Him to change me, my desires and my wants. I'm going to trust Him to change me, my life and my church. Think about the ant and grow wise. Listen, this morning, there's no reason for any of us to leave this place feeling less than adventurous because God has called us. like he called Abraham, like he called Simon and Andrew and James and John. Come follow me. Come on the adventure.